come from in the international education market in your country? So we start
over here.
Gentleman sitting next
sure.
to me, Andrews.
Yeah, well, thank you. I'm the CEO of Open Education, and Open Education runs basically two brands. One is Open English, and the other one is Next You. Open English is the leading online English school in Latin America. So we operate basically in Spanish-speaking Latin America and Brazil, so that's 21 markets in total. Our main markets are Brazil, Mexico, Argentina, Colombia, among others. And for the Next You side, Next You is a digital and technology skills platform. So we have 24 careers at the moment. We teach things like digital marketing, web development, coding, among others. And there we're in Spanish-speaking Latin America. We're soon to launch in Brazil next year. I should also mention we have a junior product that we launched earlier this year that's also in all of Spanish-speaking Latin America, so 20 markets in all. It's a product similar to what you would see here with kind of VIP Kid, but for, again, for the Latin American region.
WeAreTalk 呢，我们是中国最领先的在线英语教育的平台之一。然后目前呢，在我们的平台上大概有15000名的外教老师我们做的是在线的用在线外教教中国人学英文。目前呢，我们的这个平台的学生呢大概接近200000然后呢，我们大概有75%的学生呢来自于是。K12，然后呢，有25%左右呢是成人，然后我们是去年6月份在纽交所上市，目前呢是，应该说是这个中国的在线教育领域吧，唯一的一家在美国主板上市的公司，然后很高兴今天来到我们这个论坛好，谢谢大家。
John, please.
Sure, thank you. My name is John Hass.I'm the CEO of Rosetta Stone. We're somewhat unique as they sit and listen to the panels over the course of the day today in that we've been using technology in education for 25 years in language, which I think is older than some of the panelists, except for myself. And we've actually been using technology literacy instruction. We also teach children to read.For almost 34 years, which when you think of the state of technology 34 years ago, and the ability to use that to teach a child to read is really quite remarkable to me. I'm not a founder, I'm the current CEO. We on the language side have taught about 20 million people. We currently work with corporations and governments andhigher education in about 77 countries around the world. In our literacy business, we're working with about 3 million kids, both native English speakers and students where that is their second language, in about 20,000 schools in the U.S. and around the world.
Hello, my name is Paul Gallish. I'm the founder and CEO of Voxy. We're a New York-based company. We have a personalized English learning platform, which we sell to corporations and to language schools around the world. From a pedagogical standpoint, we firmly believe in task-based learning, increasing body of research that shows sort of learning through doing and learning about things that are relevant to your vocation or your educational pursuits is a far more effective way to learn. So we've developed career-aligned English, which can help people all over the world attain their goals.
Great, thank you, Paul. We all talk about globalization, so we'd like to know what core competencies does globalization demand from talent in the workforce? I want to start from John because I think among all of our companies sitting here representing my EO, maybe Rosetta Stone within the 35 years of history is the longest. So globalization is recent, facing a lot of challenges. And in the past 30 years, it has its Trump time and it has its low time. So what's your opinion on that, and what competencies do you believe is important for going forward?
Thank you. It's a very good question. I think as it relates to language, as the business that we're all in, there are, of course, the obvious benefits that I think the less obvious but increasingly well understood benefits directly relate to globalization. When I think about it, I was actually in the investment banking business for about 20 years. I think about the kind of people I would have looked to hire and to work with, and they would be people who were knew how to take a smart, calculated risk, who had empathy, who knew how to work across cultures, and not just speak a language, but understand the culture. People that were lifelong learners, not just people with knowledge, but the ability to continue to acquire knowledge. I think those are the skills that certainly I've valued throughout my career. And interestingly, I think with language learning, it isn't just it's not just a means to an end. There are actually other benefits for the brain and for the development as a person and as a business person as well.
Andreas, would you like to elaborate on that?
Yeah, sure. So I'll complement what John is saying. You know, I think in terms of globalization, one of the interesting things that comes together with that is the rise and spread of new technologies. And in particular, we think about technologies like AI and virtual reality, augmented reality, and the impact that has on the global workforce. And you know, one interesting thing is, you know, what jobs are going to survive, you know, given globalization and the rise of these technologies in the future, especially with NextU, but also with Open English, we think a lot about that. And you know, our conclusion and kind of the thesis under which we operate is that it's going to be those traits that are uniquely human, the ones that will survive. So with that, I think most experts would agree that it's things like creativity and deep listening comprehension, complex communication, problem solving, and these sorts of things. So, for example, at Open English, our focus is exclusively mostly on fluency. So, whereas offline schools will focus on a lot of grammar in our region, in Latin America, so people become kind of experts in the past progressive tense of every verb. You know, they're not able to speak and actually defend themselves in a job interview or in the workplace. So, our focus is on putting them in touch with an on-demand native English teacher 24/7, so they can actually improve their listening comprehension, improve their verbal fluency, which makes a big difference, and that's kind of irreplaceable, we think, with AI, at least in the foreseeable future. And as far as NextU, we do some of the same, right? So we think that those characteristics that I mentioned before, if you take an approach which is a project-based, and meaning if you're going to develop a website, and you start to, which is one of our one-year courses, which is web development and web design, and you teach our students about what is proper design, how to engage with your audience, and these sorts of things, and these projects are then graded by experts in the field. That sort of thinking, that sort of critical thinking, is what promotes the types of traits that we think will survive again these technologies and globalization in the long term.
Thank you, Andreas. And Jack will save you for the last one. And Paul, you mentioned task-based learning is very important for your company. So how do you believe task-based learning can enable the competencies they just mentioned very important for globalization? And what else do you believe is important?
Well, I'll echo what Andre said. I think creativity and things that require empathy are clearly the last thing that the robots will sort of take. But if you think about how things are shifting over time, industries are breaking down into different job functions, but job functions are breaking down into specific skills, right? There's sort of a gig economy that people are having shorter jobs and people are being hired to do much more specific project-based work. I think that's an overall trend that's going to continue. So we want to teach the English that will be mapped to those specific skills that you need, whether that's an ability to give a presentation in front of a room or negotiation, or in the case of some, you know, lower or middle skill work, you know, it might be, do you have the English necessary to operate this machine safely? That's sort of how our pedagogical approach to teaching aligns with sort of the campus.
Thank you, Paul. So Jack, 创业项目更大的挑战。And we start from answers again. Is English your mother tongue or Spanish?
In my native tongue?
Yeah.
So I was born in Venezuela, and so I learned Spanish first from my parents, although I had the opportunity of living in the United States and did elementary school there. So I learned English pretty much, I don't know, what do you guys think? It's I have my issues sometimes with prepositions and stuff, but it sounds pretty native.
You couldn't care. Great. So from your personal and professional experiences, how do you believe language learning and international curricula will better serve as carrier in developing global talent? Certainly, you are a great example of the global talent.
Well, thank you. So with Open Education, you know, over time, we now have over 600,000 students in the 21 countries that have enrolled in our programs. So we've been able to scale our educational solutions to hundreds of thousands of people that really needed English, and now more and more with Next U, need upskilling in the careers that are, I would say, of the future, but they're really the careers of now. So we've done this by having programs that are 100% online. We don't have any physical infrastructure, we don't have any schools, we don't have any classrooms that we need to build, we don't have to pay kind of an electrical bill or people to clean them and take care of them. So I think that model has really allowed us to scale faster. Now, as we've developed our models, I can bring up a couple of themes that we're running into that I think are very important for the continued scaling and success of the types of models that we're involved in. I think one that we're running into is the importance of just diversifying credentialing, especially with Next University. And with that, I mean that, obviously in past decades, if you went to a renowned university, you would get an accredited degree, and that was worth something. And while that's still the case, that model doesn't scale as well when you want to train hundreds of thousands of people quickly. And it's also a model that, for example, our iOS app development course has changed twice in the last 18 months because Apple has changed the way you have to program apps. It would be very hard for an accredited university to move at that speed and get new programs out the door and accredited and train those teachers, et cetera. So there's a clear need for these online kind of more nimble solutions, but we need to find a way to credential and validate these certificates that's universally accepted so that employers can really understand the value of them. So that's something that we're working hard to do in our markets. And the way we're doing it, by the way, is a bit different than some of the companies in the US. If you think about companies like Coursera that have partnered with actual formal universities and produced programs with them, or Udacity, they've partnered with notable corporate partners that they co-develop their content, like with Google and Facebook for digital marketing, for example. In our case, what we've done is we're building a network of hiring partners that allows us to then create a pathway to employment for the people that finish a program at Open English or Next University. And ultimately, that's the thing they want the most. More than a degree, they want a job, and they want a better job. And so again, that's a way to diversify that credentialing and to validate. So I think that's one important theme we're seeing. I won't overextend myself. I think the other important theme is the one that we touched on, and maybe we can speak more in a little bit, which is the rise of all these new technologies and how they're going to impact the way we teach.
That will be the next question for all of you. Great.
Yeah.
And Paul and John, would you like to elaborate on that topic? How can that language learning and international curricula better serve as carrier for developing global talent?
Yeah, I mean, I think about the ability to speak English as really a prerequisite to get a number of the, as you said, the Eastern jobs of the future, but literally jobs of today. And it's really a global marketplace. We heard data science is the sexiest job this year, right? 7 years ago, that was social media marketer, and in another few years, we have no idea really what that's going to be. But I think one thing we can all be sure of is there's going to continue to be a supply and demand imbalance for the most sought after skills. And by the way, I agree with what Andres was alluding to, that the line between sort of job training and then formal education is blurring, more by the day. But anyway, so I do believe that an ability to speak a common language will remove friction from the marketplace and will allow people to find jobs faster.
Great. John?
I think it's been pretty well covered. There was one interesting thing, though, that I saw for those of you that might have read the Washington Post today. There was an article about a study that was just released by the University of California, Berkeley, and the University of Chicago. That, and it sounds like we may talk about emerging technologies, but this spoke to the power of actual human communication. And the thrust of the study was when people hear an argument from someone, either in person or even by videotape, they're much more likely to appreciate the argument, to empathize and understand the person, even if they absolutely disagree with the argument that is being made, than if they read the argument on a piece of paper, if they receive it in email, if they receive it in any other form. Which tells me, and as we globalize our economy, as we become more pulled apart in some ways, where we have to work across borders, that the ability to still be able to communicate person to person is vitally important, I think, in ways that we're only beginning to truly understand.
Great, thank you. And Jeff, would you like to add on?
我刚刚其实讲到了说中国在我们这一代人上面呢，其实在语言的学习上面，在这个语言的习得上面是有很多遗憾的。但是呢，我们其实非常欣喜的看到，由于这个互联网教育的时代，其实中国的下一代人我们这个现在的这些小孩子们我们现在刚刚讲过的，我们大概70%以上都是这个 K-12 的学生，其中大部分的是这个小学生。其实我们看到现在这一代的孩子们，他们在新的环境下长大，他们从小接触这个互联网教育他们从小可以接受到最高质量的外教的资源。其实我看到他们这一代人的英语的学习已经完全不一样了，所以我们可以期待当他们长大的时候，那么那个时候的这个国际化人才的这个概念，可能跟我们今天的想象又会非常完全的会不同然后呢，另外呢就是像我刚刚也讲到，其实我们自己也是认为呢，就是一个真正的一个这个全球化下的一个中国的未来的中国人我们觉得除了有语言的这个能力以外，那么他的像现在国际化的一些思维，比如说像美国非常强调的问题分析能力、问题解决能力、批判性思维能力，就这些比较重要的这些核心的素养，其实呢，我们也在就拿我们自己来举例哈，我们自己呢，我们的核心课程是我们自己的这个研发人员去开发的。那我们在开发我们的核心课程的时候呢，就把这些刚刚讲的这些比较重要的一些国际化的这些思维的理念，会放到我们课程开发当中去。所以我们不仅仅是去教下一代的语言，我们更重要的是教会他们国际化的思维方式所以我们觉得就是在基于现在的这个中国的互联网教育的发展这个态势。对于中国的下一代确实是非常的充满期待
其实大家看到川普总统来中国的时候，很重要的一项是他的外孙女说了几首唐诗，唱了中国的歌，所以未来的国际化人才其实不仅是讲英文，可能讲中文，讲其他语言也很重要我们下一个问题是I will ask you in English, how will science and technology promote the development of international education and in the other sense, we see technology is also a double-edged sword. So it's not only the positive impact, that could be tremendous challenges and risks. And what do you foresee that? So we start from Andreas.
Sure. No, it's a really great question, one that we spent a lot of time thinking about. And I think for us, it comes down to whether these new technologies are going to ultimately replace teachers or they're going to augment our learning and teaching experiences, right? And we're on the side of augmentation, meaning that we think that as these new technologies come online, and I'm referring to a few in particular, I think AI is a clear one, I think augmented reality is another one, virtual reality and machine learning, those can all really enhance the learning experience. So for example, we developed an application that we released recently in some Latin American countries it's going very well, and this is a mobile application called a Chat by Open English. And what it does, the reason it started is that we wanted to put an app that you basically had access to a teacher 24/7, so our students could chat with teachers through asynchronous, like if you were on WeChat with a teacher on the other side. Obviously that gets pretty expensive, right, because you need hundreds of teachers to be manning the other side of the chat box. So we started integrating a bot, and this bot started learning. And in the last 6 months, the bot now has a name. Her name is Abby, and it's the teacher Abby. And Abby now responds to 98% of the chats that our students are writing to her, right? So in the 2% that Abby cannot answer, we actually have a human teacher that takes over, but now we need a lot less teachers than we did before. And by the way, we can reorient the value and the time of those teachers to the things that matter the most, like assessment, correction, and others, right? So I think that's a clear example of how technology allows us to augment an experience, how it allows us to actually do more with less and scale the business faster. You can also imagine, you know, an English learning world that is actually now not just static or kind of asynchronous lessons. You can imagine a world that is, you know, enhanced by augmented reality, or even better, just virtual reality. And I think many of our brands in the next 5 years may be developing virtual reality worlds where you step in and you'll see a picture of New York, but you actually step into New York and you interact with different people and they teach you the language, right? And so, I think that the brands and the companies will persist, but it's important that the products evolve at the pace of technology. And in summary, for us, it's augmentation, not replacement.
Great. Thank you, Andrew. You're very positive. I say you're very positive.
I'm wrong.
Jack.
我觉得呢，这个，首先我觉得我们对于技术呢，永远不能低估它的作用啊。就是我觉得现在我们整个现在在中国的互联网教育行业中看到的这些技术，很有可能跟未来的3到5年的这种发展的速度啊，我们很有可能还是在低估这个技术所发生的作用啊。我觉得这个。具体来讲，我觉得有可能，从我们企业拿这个 RealTalk 举例的话，我觉得呢，首先呢，比如说像大数据，对于教育的作用，我们已经看到在发挥非常重要的作用。举个例子，比如说我们有15000的老师，我们有这个200000的学生，那么该如何去帮助我们的学生去寻找最适合他的这个老师？那么我们呢，自己有一个专门的大数据的团队，在做不断的优化我们的算法。通过学生的满意度，因为我们的每一节课后呢会有这个学生对这个老师的评价，我们会基于这些评价，基于学生对老师的收藏，我们会基于这些去做这些这个优化的算法，然后呢最后呢是不断的在看到我们的学生的满意度呢是在逐渐提升，我们在帮助学生去更好的去找到他最喜欢的这个老师，所以我们看到技术已经在发挥很大的作用。那么另外呢另外一个非常大的趋势呢，是这个人工智能。我虽然自己并不 believe 这个人工智能在语言的教学领域能够完全的取代老师，我觉得在可见的未来这个还是很难的。但是呢，我确实我也相信呢，人工智能对于在未来对于这个对于优化，对于这个提高我们的教学效率，比如说我们的老师在做很多督促学生学习的工作，我们有很多助教的工作，那么这些都是非常有可能甚至是完全应该在未来被机器所替代的。那么这样的一些工作呢，这样的一些人工智能的尝试，其实在 RealTalk 我们也已经在开始在做了因为我们要想真的让学生有这个效果，非常其实很多时候很重的服务是需要的，但是呢这些并不必须要靠人去实现，它完全是可以靠人工智能去实现啊。所以我觉得可能在大数据和人工智能方面是未来这个技术能够极大的改变国际化教育的这个方面。
好，
Maybe I'll talk about concerns for just a moment. My biggest concern and something that we think about a lot is that we not allow the formthe form of delivery to cause people to lose sight of what we're ultimately focused on, which is the outcome. And is the product delivered with efficacy? We've always believed that if something is personalized, if it's effective, if it's engaging, then if it's relevant to a student, it will work. Our oldest company, which again has been using technology to teach children grade for 34 years,is also the one that is most focused on outcome. We use true medical type journal studies. We've done 9 journal studies with control groups and everything else to follow and track the outcome of that business, even as the underlying technology in that business has changed dramatically over the last 34 years. That's ultimately what is most important. And I think when I watch ed tech companies fail, it's because even ones that are seemingly successful for a period of time, it's because they were too focused on how something was being delivered as opposed to what the actual outcome that they were trying to create is. Are children actually learning, or adults learning, or getting the outcomes that you want? AI, AR, VR don't necessarily create that in and of itself. The underlying themes of how people learn have been the same for many, many years, not for hundreds of years. These can all help. But if they just cause us to lose sight of actually achieving the outcome that we're trying to achieve, then it will not ultimately serve the purpose that we all hope for.
Great, thank you, John.
I mean, I agree with most of what's been said, and internally at Voxy we think quite a bit about sort of about blended learning. I think everyone, you know, we're all sort of coming at it from the digital standpoint. 95% of the English learning market is coming at it from a face-to-face point of view, and everyone pretty much agrees that blended will ultimately produce the best outcomes and will have the highest efficacy. Our chief education officer always says that we should use humans to do what people do best, and use computers to do what technology does best. And that's sort of going to be our guiding principle. You know, we know already that you know, data analytics and the little bit of machine learning that we already have can do a great job at sequencing learning objects. It's fantastic. And that's a part of a teacher's job that they hate. Lesson planning sucks. So technology can absolutely, at scale, create personalized curricula for the masses. That's a fantastic thing. Are you going to have the empathy and nurturing? I think that was one of the slides today that Chris Whittle was talking about, is the teacher as the nurturer. Which, by the way, I thought was a great contrast to yesterday, the Chinese character for teaching, which was the teacher with the stick giving the content and the students. Anyone see that? Yeah. It's pretty funny. But anyway, that's...
Great, thank you, Paul. How are we doing in time,
Yen? It's 5 more minutes.
Okay. So, I think I need to summarize them. My last question will be about China, because not all of you have entered in the Chinese market, but we have the biggest population here, and we have more English speakers than any other countries in the world. So maybe John and Paul, you would like to briefly elaborate on what's your marketing or marketing plan in China? What's your plan about entering China? Do you have any plan here?
Well, I'm actually here trying to figure that out. it is a market that you can't ignore, as massive and bewilderingly fragmented as the English learning market is, somewhere around $100 billion of spend. I think I learned from John's 10K. China's a huge part of that, so sort of TBD for boxing.
John?
Yeah, I'm convinced it will be very important for us in the future. I think there's a question as to whether we'll do that directly or with a partner. I think there are great advantages for our business in working with partners around the globe. We found that to be successful for us recently. It is important to me, though. I'm reminded my child goes to school that was founded by a man named John Dewey, who is probably the leading progressive educator in the U.S. And I was just reading about his trip to China. He came and gave 200 lectures approximately in and around Beijing, principally. And he talked about all the things that we've been talking about today, task-based learning. He talked about the lifelong learner. He talked about creating a culture, a child who has the character and the knowledge, not just the vocational skill, all of the things that we're still talking about today, which reinforces for me that the underlying principles of education are all the same. They're the same here, they're the same in the US. It's the application of those principles, and I believe we can all be successful here. It's a huge market, and I think we can all bring something.
And Andres, do you have any plan, or you are already entering China?
No, we have not launched in China. And we're also here evaluating potential partnerships. And I think similar to John, I think our natural inclination is to find a partner to to bring our brands to China or to power some of the brands that are already here. So we're currently evaluating that, as well as figuring out how some Chinese companies that have an interest in more of a global aspiration can also go to Latin America.
I believe in the audience we have a lot of potential partners you can come to. And Jack, the last question for you. Do you have any plan to enter in the international market beyond China?
作为一家我们这样的公司来讲，其实呢，聚焦还是很重要的。所以我们看到中国的市场其实非常的大，所以我们很会还是先聚焦在这个中国的市场。国际化可能是我们也许是3年或者5年以后的这个计划。另外，其实我可以也可以给其他三位嘉宾一些建议。我觉得中国市场呢，其实非常的大，但是呢，中国市场它也是非常的分层的。就是我觉得找准这个切入点，找好这个合作伙伴一定会有很大的机会。
Thank you. And once again, thank you very much for these distinguished panelists, and let's give them a great applause. Thank you.
Thank you.